but I will praise the Lord. Oh, I will praise the Lord. No matter what tomorrow brings, what it has in store, I know I will praise the Lord. Oh, I will praise the Lord. I will praise the Lord. No matter what tomorrow brings, or what it has in store, I know I will praise the Lord. This may be a prison, oh, and these may be chains, but still I am free, oh, I am free to praise His name. And in tribulation, heart still sings, He is my Messiah, oh, He is the King of Kings. Prisoners started waking up, singing filled their ears. Some men started swearing, oh, but others were in tears. And then suddenly it happened, oh, there was no mistake. As Paul and Silas praised the Lord, oh, the walls began to shake. Oh, I will praise the Lord. I will praise the Lord. No matter what tomorrow brings, or what it has in store, I know I will praise the Lord. Oh, I will praise the Lord. I will praise the Lord. No matter what tomorrow brings, what it has in store, I know I will praise the Lord.
Sing again now. Oh, I will praise the Lord. Sing, I will praise the Lord. No matter tomorrow brings, what it has in store, I will praise the Lord. Let's give the Lord a hand. Amen. Amen. You may have your seats for a moment. Man, we have Sister Chastity. She has a special testimony she would like to give. If she could come this morning at this time. Amen.
Nervous now. I've had this on my heart since before Christmas, but Satan sent one attack after another, and he's just not gonna have the last word on this. For anyone that doesn't know, I was diagnosed with multiple sclerosis just over 3 years ago, and what that does is it attacks the nerves and can lead to loss of control of your body, as well as horrible pain. And I'd been living like that for years before the diagnosis. Medicine started to really help, but I still had horrible pain every single day. And numbness, if I would stand or walk for more than just a couple minutes, I couldn't get through a song service without having to sit. And at the Harvest Festival in 2020, Brother Richie Douglas had talked about his experience with the Lord, and it inspired my faith to start claiming the token over my unsaved family, but it also made me examine how I applied the token to myself and God's promises for healing. And I just realized that my faith had really been decimated by Satan through the years. But during his sermon the next morning, I felt prompted to get up and get prayed for. And it was the first time I had had hands laid on me since being diagnosed. We hadn't had a church home for a couple years before coming to Bethel. And sorry, I'm looking at my note. I wrote, it affected every day, every hour, and every minute of my life. I was an utter slave and bondage to those symptoms for over 2 years at the time. As I approached the altar, my prayer was that I wanted to be free of it. And I really believe it was that mental approach that God honored. Not only did I believe that he could and would, but I desperately wanted it. And I didn't put any, you know, safety precautions on that. Well, Lord, you know, if you say no, I just said, I want free. I want to be free. And I knew he was offering it. And, you know, I think too often we approach God afraid that he'll say no, or we don't allow our hope to go high enough. We never even reach that level of faith that Brother Branham talks about, and we have no substance behind it. But this time, I knew I had some substance. And, you know, I'd been living for years just managing the symptoms, and I never really kicked the devil out. I kind of put him in a box and said, well, I can handle this. But it was different this day. And by the time I got back to my seat, the numbness and pain was gone. And I haven't had any pain or symptoms since then. It's been over a year now. And I'm believing and praising God that one day soon my doctors will be talking about how I'm a miracle, and my scans show that I have no MS. I have MRIs at the end of the month, and if it's still showing up then it'll be the next year, or the year after that, or however long it'll take. When I got the diagnosis, I was devastated. But right after that, something in me rose up and said, God's gonna use this for his glory. And I never could have imagined then that I'd be standing here saying these things now. And I just wanna say that as a church, we've heard a message over the last 2 years that we've been here that God will restore. And I'm a living testimony that God is restoring my health, and I know he will restore all other things Satan has stolen from us if we claim it.
Big hand, amen. 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 Let's stand, amen. I saw the Lord, and he answered me and delivered me from every fear. Those who look on him are radiant, never be ashamed. Never be ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard me and saved me from my enemies. Sing now. The Son of God surrounds his saints. Never them. Oh, he'll deliver them. Sing, magnify. Come exalt him. His name. Glorify. The Lord is good. Oh, blessed is he who hides in him. Oh, fear the Lord. Oh, all ye saints, he'll give you everything. He'll give you everything. Sing, magnify the Lord, sing with me, come exalt him, his name. Forever, oh. this poor man cry, and the Lord heard me and saved me from my enemy. Amen. Give me the key of D. Amen. God is good all the time. Put a song of praise in this heart of mine. God is good. Say all the time. Through the darkest night, His light will shine. God is good. God is good all the time. Say, if you're walking through the valley and there are shadows all to praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. I command my hands to praise the Lord. 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 Say, hands, you have to praise the Lord. Hands, you have to praise the Lord. Say, hands, you have to praise the Lord. Hands, you have to praise the Lord. I command my feet to praise the Lord. I command my feet to praise the Lord. Say, feet, you have to praise the Lord. Say, feet, you have to praise the Lord. Say, feet, you have to praise the Lord. Put our hands together. I command my hands to praise the Lord. I command my hands to praise the Lord. I command my hands to praise the Lord. Say, hands, you have to praise the Lord. The Lord, say, I command my feet to praise the Lord. I command my feet to praise the Lord. I command my feet to praise the Lord. Feet now, feet, you have to praise the Lord. Whoa. Feet, you have to praise the Lord. Say, I command my hands to praise the Lord. Let's get the Lord a wave offering. I command my hands to praise the Lord. I command my hands to praise the Lord. I command my hands to praise the Lord. Say, hands, you have to praise the Lord. Say, seated. Amen. We're going to get Brother Aaron to give us a song this morning. Amen. Amen. Let's give Brother Aaron a hand.
Man, God bless you, saints. Weary traveler, beat down from the storms you have weathered, feels like this road might go on forever and carry on. You keep on giving. And every day this world just keeps on taking. Your tired heart is on the edge of breaking. Carry on. Weary traveler, restless soul, you were never meant to walk this road alone. It'll all be worth it, just hold on. Weary traveler, you won't be weary long. No more searching. Heaven's healing's gonna find where all the hurt is. When Jesus calls, we'll lay down all our heavy burdens. Carry on, weary traveler, restless soul. Never meant to walk this road alone. It'll all be worth it. Just hold on, weary traveler. You won't be weary long. No, you won't be weary long. Won't be weary long. Someday soon we're gonna make it home. Someday soon we're gonna make it home. Someday soon we're gonna make it home. Make it home. Oh, someday soon we're gonna make it home. Someday soon we're gonna make it home. Someday soon we're gonna make it home. Gonna make it home. Weary traveler, restless soul, you were never meant to walk this road alone. It'll all be worth it. Just hold on, weary traveler. You won't be weary long. Oh, weary traveler, you won't be.
Call Brother Matt Smith to give us a special this morning. Amen. Let's give him a hand. Amen. Amen.
Forsaken. I wonder, is your love for me still real? Though my friends think I am happy, unaffected by this trial, they can't see the pain I'm hiding. just underneath my smile. Master, can't live this way anymore. So today I make my choice. I choose to believe that you are faithful, and my heart is in your hands. And this mystery that I face today is part of a greater plan. I choose not to be discouraged when the sun will not break through. I have a choice of trusting you. So, Lord, this is what I choose. I know this road will not be easy. I know I'll have my weaker days, and Satan will tell me I don't mean it. When I say I'll trust God all the way, but that really doesn't matter. I refuse to hear him out. With my faith I'll find the power that'll overcome all doubt. Lord, I've never felt so strong as when I'm resting in your arms. I choose to believe that you are faithful, and my heart is in your hands. And this mystery that I face today is part of a greater plan. I choose not to be discouraged when the sun will not break through. I have a choice of trusting you. So, Lord, this is what I choose. I choose to believe that you are faithful, and my heart is in your hands. And this mystery that I face today is part of a greater plan. I choose not to be discouraged when the sun will not break through. I have a choice of trusting you. So, Lord, this is what I choose.
Amen. How many are ready for the word? Amen. Amen. Let us stand. Amen. Let's sing, "Where Could I Go But to the Lord?" Amen. Living below in this old sinful world, hardly a comfort can afford. Striving alone to face temptation sore. Where could I go but to the Lord? Let's put our hands together. Where could I go? Oh, where could I go? Seeking a refuge for my soul. the Lord. Well, life here is grand with friends I love so dear. Comfort I get from God's own word. Yet when I face, say, the chilly hand,
and happy to have you all here. Amen, Brother Kenneth, good to see you made it in. Praise the Lord. Little man is recovering still, hey? Amen, praise the Lord. Number of people to welcome, Brother Donovan and Sister Stephanie Fisher from Ohio. Wave at me. Oh, right there in the back. Oh, I met your son outside. I can see the resemblance. Yeah, I tried to greet him, but he just like gave me the stare. Amen, handsome little man. Sister Stephanie Sheffield from Brother Josh Bennett's with her sister Lisa and her mom, Sister Linda Jackson, are right here. Amen, praise the Lord. Happy to have them today and happy to have all of you all. Amen. Brother Kenneth is here scouting for a new home for his family, moving here, kind of underway with plans to relocate here from Arizona. So let's be praying for Brother Kenneth. I think you're looking at a house in the Pooler area. I thought it was, Brother Kenneth. Praise the Lord. Amen. Then I heard Brother Joe and Sister Rachel, is it? How to Shell sold. Amen. Sold their house. And so they're also trying to find a house here locally. Brother George and Sister Andrea sold their house. Praise the Lord. So now they're, amen. Amen. So they're trying to get here a little closer than Hilton Head. Amen. That's pretty much the end of the world. Well, no, Fripp's kind of the end of the world, but Hilton Head is out there too. So amen. Amen. Wanting to make it a little bit closer into town. Amen. We got a lot going on. So I get that. Amen. It's good to be in striking distance. Amen. So we're happy in the Lord. Happy to have all of you here in the house of God today. Amen. I was enjoying that Sister Chastity's testimony. Amen. And the specials. Amen. Wonderful, wonderful God we serve. Amen. Revelation chapter 1. Amen. We're going to just go right back there from our text last Sunday. We were looking to come with this message, and we want to go right back there today. To Revelation chapter 1. I see. That makes sense. Okay. I was trying to figure out why I had a file confusion. Amen. But I have it now. Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. Now, in our text here, excuse me, I'm just making sure that I'm synced correctly. And we are not going to take a chance. Yeah, the enemy's going to try to mess with me. It's all right. How many, y'all remember what I tell him all the time? You ain't nobody. You ain't nobody. I tell the devil, you ain't nobody. Amen. You don't make decisions about my life. Amen. I don't live by his mercy. Live by the mercy of the Lord Jesus Christ. He has no say in your life. If you really get a revelation of that, you know, you'll put him in his place. He has zero say about your life. Anything that comes my way comes under the purview of my Father in heaven. And amen. So this is why Peter could say that, you know, even trials that come, even fiery, fiery ones. That's pretty fiery ones. But Peter shows us that they're for our good. They're more precious than gold. You know, sometimes if you'll just change the word trial to training, you'll feel a lot better by it. Amen? So the next time you feel like you're in a fiery trial, just say, I'm in some fiery training. Amen. Because that's really, amen, what it's all about. Revelation chapter 1, we're just going to catch two verses and let you be seated. Verse 9 and 10. Revelation chapter 1, verse 9 and 10. I, John, who also am your brother and companion in tribulation and in the kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ, was in the isle that is called Patmos for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. Verse 10, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day and heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet. Let's bow our heads. Father, we thank you for your word now, Lord. It just means everything to us. We have committed ourselves into your hands for service now, Lord, and we go forward with confidence, feeling your fresh anointing, Lord, opening notes in my back office and realizing you yet had things you wanted to say and add and edit. So, Father, we're just here now following your lead. We commit ourselves into your hands. May you bless all of the hearers of your word here, Lord, and across the air, and those who perhaps will catch it at a later time on recording. We commit it all to you now. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, friends. You can be seated. I heard Brother Luther reading the announcement that we read Wednesday. I was actually had every intention of sending that out as a reminder to you. Don't think I got around to that. Amen. Brother Ken, I apologize. Didn't get that, but I'm glad you had Luther catch that. Amen. Amen. Is that the Nero thumbs down? I mean, that's pretty bad. That means, yeah, you don't want the Nero thumb. No. Amen. Praise the Lord. Last time we were, and just have my PowerPoint ready, please, Brother Caleb. Thank you kindly. Let me go off and come back on to make sure we're good and running. All right. Last time we were speaking about how that we have arrived at an age for total victory. Now, how many will agree with that? This is the end time. There's a lot said about wickedness of the end time. I'm going to say some things about it today as a cautionary tale from the scriptures. But you know, it is a time of exceptional evil, but it's also a time of exceptional deliverance. It is a time of exceptional deception, but it is also a time of exceptional revelation. Amen? Amen? We have reached a time where perfect faith that is to operate in the church as it did in the book of Acts is to repeat in our day. Now, that's not to suggest we've just now arrived at it. The Holy Ghost has been moving all through the ages, but we realize that when the bride tree was completely restored with fruit back in the top of the tree under the presence of the sun, with the sun shining on it in its strength, then we realize that that church of that day would write another book of Acts behind it. Now, it's not so much there's not so much emphasis on us, you know, sitting down and putting pen to paper, because we realize that according to as Brother Branham was relating Brother Junior Jackson's dream, how that it was white stone in which there was no writing. And we found through the teaching of the scripture that, of course, there wouldn't be writing on that. There was writing on the outside. But there was no writing on the inside because this mystery was going to be written behind skin. Amen? Amen? The word interpreted is a manifestation of the name of God. Yes. Right? In the white stone, a new name is given. Amen? So it makes sense to us that the book of Acts that we are writing is a chronicle of the last day church. Remember, as I've said to you before, the book of Acts in the Bible, the book of Acts was written because people acted. Yeah. Amen. People moved. People went forward. And it was a chronicling of their activities. It is not a chronicling of the Acts of the Apostles, as sometimes Bible translators will put that in their Bibles. But it is more perfectly a chronicling of the life and ministry of Jesus Christ in his church. Amen. So we realize then that we've come to this age of total victory, total deliverance, perfect faith, the bride coming to a perfect image, and therefore we ought to have, and we have a right to expect, and we have a right to expect from God liberty in Christ. And God has a right to expect in us that we will be the continuation of the Word of God. Do you believe that? Do you accept His gift and do you accept the responsibility? See, we're not here to treat Him like Santa Claus. All right? He's not, as you've heard me say over the years, He's not a vending machine. You don't get in trouble and go drop two or three quarters in God and say, I need out of this jam. No, he. Remember Paul. I'm getting ahead of myself. I'll reference it again later. But remember that Paul tells the Ephesian church in the third chapter. He starts speaking about the fellowship of a mystery, and we find out this is a person who wants to have fellowship with you. The mystery wants fellowship. See, he's only a mystery to the world who are not in fellowship. When you're not in fellowship with him, his actions to you are a mystery. You don't understand. Why this happened to me? Why did this happen to me? Well, that's a mystery to you because you're not in fellowship with the one who could make all things clear. See? So John said, I turned to see who spoke behind me. He goes on. We didn't continue in that reading today. We got it last week. So we remember, friends, and this is a vital part of the piece of the puzzle that the world, as we said last time, I'm just recapping a wee bit, the world is far too challenging for you not to operate in the Spirit. Amen. Now, I really want to drill down on that today. The world is too challenging. It's far too wicked. There are too many existential threats to you, to your mental state, to your physical health, to the spiritual condition of your children and your home. And your marriage, it's much too dire for you not to have a purpose to live every day in the Spirit. To be every day in fellowship with Christ so that He's not a mystery to you. People who are not where you are a mystery to them. This has an effect on the fact that Jesus says, what fellowship hath light with darkness? Now, that's not just a command for you to have no fellowship with darkness. That's also a little bit of help for you to understand why darkness doesn't want to fellowship with you. So that you don't get a complex to know. Jesus would say, listen, they persecuted me before you. So understand, the whole thing is they're not going to fellowship with you. I remember I was out in Fort Worth preaching for the Fort Worth area there in Texas, preaching for Brother David McGarry and I you all get this immediately. And we're sitting in the back, and it was the last service, and man, I was sitting in the back office, and boy, was I gassed and just out of breath and out of wind. And Brother David, you know, started chuckling at me. He's probably at least 15, 20 years my senior. And he's chuckling, saying, oh, you know, you need to learn how to modulate that. Or I forget the word he used, regulate it or something like that. And I said, Brother David, do tell. I said, I've never in 30 plus years of ministry, I never figured out how to do it. I've tried to do it. I try to regulate, modulate, govern it, you know, pace myself. I said, but man, it gets so delicious. I just stomp the gas and it goes to the floor and opens the four barrel and away she goes. And I said, I can't hardly hold it in. I said, how do you regulate it? Tell me in your senior years of experience, how do you do it? And he turned around and poked me in the chest and he goes, you won't have to do anything. He said, this thing you're living in will do it for you. I said, well, that's probably not what I wanted to hear, but I said, you won't have to do a thing. This thing you're living in will do it for you. Amen. So we find out that, you know, it's a time to live in the Spirit, to be in fellowship with Christ, so that he's not and his movements are not such a mystery in your life. Now, we read these quotes for you last time, and I feel the need. I'm only 9 minutes in, so just it's okay. I'm pacing myself. And we read these quotes last time. Brother Branham said, now what is it? Christ coming to his body. Christ is the Word. We all know the anointing is Christ that comes on the Word and makes the Word live. Is that right? That is the anointing. Christ is the anointing, the Spirit that comes upon the Word, that quickens the Word to make it live. Now the Word is in your heart. You believe in divine healing, whatever more. See, in Christ, the anointing coming to his body. See the connection there? Just like husband and wife to become one. Now the church has got to get to the ministry until the church and Christ become one. He can anoint you for every blessing that's in the Bible. All of it is yours. I mean, everything promised at this age is yours. Good news. Everything promised for this age is yours. So why don't you get a hold of it? Why don't you avail yourselves of the benefits of it? Say, how do I do it? Live in the Spirit. How do I do that? Fellowship with the mystery. See? Let the Holy Spirit, let, allow, permit. Permit, allow. Let the Holy Spirit come upon any person that's truly got something down there. A healing comes from the inside. Let that leading come from the Holy Spirit that's in you. If it's a genuine Spirit anointing, the gene seed, it can't do nothing but bear a son or daughter of God. So when we come to it at this point now, I'm already have my PowerPoint up here I just now realized I actually have it. So I want you to read with me here, Mark 13:23. So Jesus now giving this, and I said to you that I was going to come to this. All right, let's watch. Mark 13:23, but take ye heed, behold, I have foretold you all things. Amen. Amen. So now I want to put some emphasis today on this word here, heed. And I promise you it's going to surprise you. It surprised me. As many times I've read through this verse and studied this out, I was quite amazed at what depth this single word has. And it's probably a little more than you have imagined. But take ye heed. Now this is the same thing as saying, you know, when Paul said, let the mind which is in Christ be in you. Amen. You have to do that. Yeah. You have to let it. Amen. You have to allow it. Amen. You have to permit it. Yeah. Amen. Because remember, we have seen the enemy and it is us. Yes. Right. That man in the mirror is the guy who's hitting me. Say, the devil hates me. Sometimes I wonder if it's the devil or the man in the mirror that wants his way so bad and tries everything in the world to avoid becoming in fellowship with this. Amen. See, but remember, the guy in the mirror is supposed to be an image of this. All right? So he's saying here, allow, permit, get to it proactively. Here's something you need to go do. Here's a task. Take heed. Amen. So I take heed of what? Everything I've said. Say, Jesus, what are you talking about? Everything that you've seen and heard of me, you need to pay attention. Amen. Because I didn't say it just to be, you know, just to be a friend or just to be a preacher. You know, I'm not here, friends, today. I am a friend to all of you. I am a pastor. I am a shepherd. But I'm also, firstly, a servant of God. And that first office takes precedent over anything else. And sometimes I have to say things that I don't want to say to a friend. But they have to be said, see? Amen. So when we look at this word, take heed. Now, it means spoken by way of caution. And here's your fancy Greek word for it. I'm not going to try to pronounce that. But it means to look into, take heed, be on watch, yes. Be aware. Now here's where it takes a turn. To be able to see, that is to say, to have the faculty of sight, and as spoken of the blind, to recover sight. There's a reference to Matthew 12. In Acts 9, when you don't have this, you're blind. Without this element operating in your life, you're blind. When he speaks here, can you turn the monitors just off? That blowing into my microphone, I don't have the little guy on here, so that's going to just irritate me. And just put it out there, I won't hear it as much. Amen. Still can hear it, so just kill these monitors on the platform. Amen. Praise the Lord. Die. Die. Stop. Stop. Amen. Can you handle that, G? What's up? Okay, they're still running, so whoever can make that happen, make that happen for me. Amen. Praise the Lord. So to be able to see, that is to say, to have the faculty of sight. So to be absent of this, it means that you're blind. Now it goes on. Let me carry on here. In the sense of to perceive as with the eyes, meaning to discern, to understand. Did you imagine the word heed would take that in? You say, if I'm going to heed something, this means I better do what I was told. But a lot of times, in order for you to successfully do that, you've got to figure out what it is you've been told. Amen? You know, you could make a mistake. You could stop doing something you need to do or start doing something you need to avoid. So when we look at it in this sense, we find that heed, and I really want you to follow closely now, that heed is not just a random generalized caution. Now that's an important point. It's not just generalized. It's not just saying, hey, take heed. Hey, be careful. Hey, be aware. That's just a general blanket statement. Hey, be cautious. I started this sermon recapping from last week saying, the hour that we live in is so evil. You need to be very careful. But now we're starting to drill down more deeply into the breakdown. It's not merely, I want to say that clearly, it's not merely just random or generalized concern. It's much more than that, and that's what Jesus is trying to get across to us. It means that you need to have the ability to perceive threats.
Amen. Amen.
I mean, you can look right at something and not know it's a threat. Amen? You can be looking right at it. It can be camouflaged. You know, creatures in the wild do that. They camouflage. And you walk right up, and you think you're seeing a stick, and it's a serpent. See, you step right on it if you're not careful. And so we realize that it's much more than just saying, oh, I see what's going on in the world today. But do you really see it? Do you really understand the spirit behind it? And you say, why is that so important? Because then you can know that this thing is much more deadly than it might appear.
Amen.
On the surface. This is so important to teenagers and young people. Because, stand by. Because it's teenagers oftentimes without the life experience,
right.
A lot of times they're smarter than their parents. I know all three of mine were.
Yeah.
But because that their life experience is limited, and mine is greater by a couple of times at least, or well, maybe not. I got married young and had them young, so. But I've got to jump on them anyway. And so we find that, I was often sometimes I couldn't explain a certain rule. I just say, listen, guys, you just have to trust me. That's a bad decision. Don't go down that path because it's not going to end well for you. Dad, how do you know? Because maybe I did it myself. Maybe I know some people that did, and it never has a good ending. And so there's this whole idea that you need to have the ability not to just see the threats. I mean, any one of us as a Christian can look at the things of the world, and we can all go, yeah, that's pretty wicked. Wow, that's pretty foul. My goodness, that's pretty twisted. But a lot of times, we can make the mistake and go, and it sounds a little more like this. Yeah, I know it's really not of God. It's kind of, but you know, it's not that big of a deal. Be careful. Be careful. Because what it might be is it might be in a seed form, and you haven't seen what it's going to grow into yet. See? And so we realize that we need to be able to see it, and we need to be able to perceive it as a threat in real time, in high definition, because the wickedness in the end time world is grave. And I really want to drill down on that today. Don't be asleep at the switch. The wickedness of the end time is at an epic level. It's more wicked, more deceptive, more cunning than it's ever been. I don't have the time today to go down the bullet list of what makes this age unique just in its wickedness alone. You've heard me say it before, how the lid is torn off of hell. We've talked about before that this is now 6,000 years since Satan has had a time to rebuild his Eden. We've talked more and more and more about how the Holy Spirit is lifting from the earth. And we can go into all kinds of ways how the earth has made Satan the God, with a little g, the God, the worshiped being of this end time age. So, you know, don't be asleep at the switch that listen, hey, sisters, young ladies, what I'm about to say, oh goodness, here he goes. Hey, listen, I'm not even in my sermon today including about how you should dress. I just want you to know this. All the designers, Satan's behind it. Just get that. Just get that. Just have that in your mind that the designers of women's fashion is the devil. Thank God we have some sites where godly sisters full of the Holy Ghost present godly apparel. Amen. And you say, what's your hope? My hope is that every teenage girl full of the Holy Spirit will dress godly. What, does that shock you? You want me to apologize for that? I will never apologize for that. I want men to be real men. I want women to be ladies. I want men to have character. I'm not here to repent for that or apologize or sugarcoat. That's what we stand for. It's what we believe. That's why you need the Holy Ghost baptism. See? The cunning of Satan, the deception of Satan. And may I say, the desperation of Satan.
Yeah, amen.
Is that a critical state? So in Revelation, we didn't read it, but in Revelation 1:12, he said, I turn to see. It's an interesting statement. I turn to see the voice. That's odd. The voice is something you hear, and he said, I heard behind me. I turn to see the voice. It's an odd way of saying it until you start to really break down the meaning behind it. I turn to see the voice means to see, first of all, where it came from, because it was behind him. And it sounded like a trumpet. It was a voice that had a projection to it, sounded like a trumpet. And he said, I turn to see the voice that spake. And being turned, see, and I saw this, and I saw this, and it sounded like a trumpet speaking. And so it not only means to see where it came from, see, but it also had commanded John's attention. It had commanded John's absolute attention. I mean, at this point, John hears behind him a voice sounds like a trumpet, and he wheels around. I can promise you, John's not thinking about his imprisonment. He's not thinking about the devil. He's saying, I heard a sound like a trumpet that spoke behind me, and I turned to see this voice, and I saw one like the Son of Man. This voice had commanded his attention. I hope it has commanded our attention. I hope that's necessary. And you say, well, isn't that pretty obvious why you need to preach on it? Because there's so many voices vying for your attention. There's never been more voices vying for your attention. But there's one voice that God has given, and it sounds like a trumpet, and it's a voice speaking. It had his attention. This is this one that he turned to see is exactly the same mystery that Paul had said he wanted you to have fellowship with. Now, only now, there's a little bit more of the layering The veil has been removed. It's not a mystery anymore. John turns around and starts describing. Paul called it a mystery. John's actually going to tell you, wait a minute. It was one like the Son of Man. Hallelujah. And I saw this, and I saw that, and I saw this, and he gave me a commission. Whatever I see, write it in a book, and I'm writing it, and here it is, church. Amen. So now it's God moving, as Paul said, to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery. Remember that that's what the book of Revelation is. It's a book less for doctrinal study, more for practical application. Amen. Say, the book of Revelation? Of course. I thought the book of James was the most applicable book. Once you understand the breakdown and the understanding of that sealed book, once it's unsealed to you, you see yourself. You see the image of Christ that he is trying to get in his bride moving. You see what's happening in the world. You have it all uncovered. It's all unlocked. And I'm here to tell you, that's why the book of Revelation is the bride's book of the last day. It wasn't even a book that the apostles had access to. They were all gone. Paul was already gone. That's why he never quotes from it. So the Revelation is 90% out of the book of Daniel. But now it's coming to a greater, because they thought Daniel just represented Israel. But the book of Revelation is going to show that it's now in his bride, his church, all the way down through seven ages. And at the end of it all, he starts talking about how that Satan has been moving and God has been moving. And this anointing went forth from the enemy, and this anointing went forth from God, and a white horse went, and a lion went, and then we go all the way down through the seals and all the way through the trumpets, working with Israel, until we come down to this hour where we see a beast system that is in control of the world and is behind entertainment, behind politics, behind recreation, behind education, behind the pulpits. It's everywhere. It's everywhere. Take heed. See clearly. Don't be deceived or fooled. It's too dire. The wickedness of the world is far too grave for you to be caught unaware of this. You'll find yourself entangled. Amen. You'll find yourself entangled. Some of you young people, you have so few entanglements just by virtue of your youth. Stay that way. Now, you can't stay young. You're going to advance forward. As much as I'd love for my grandkids to have stayed little munchkins, they're grown up into adults. But I want to say, in your mind and in your heart, stay disentangled from the world, because it offers nothing for you but pain and suffering and contamination and injury and illness. Things that you can take on you that can take years, if God's not merciful, take years to throw off. Yeah. Amen. Parents, be careful. These are treacherous times. You parents, care. Have a care, as the Brits would say. Have a care about your children. Amen. Have a care what you bring into the home. Amen. Care about that. It's vital. See, we don't know how much longer we're going to be here, but It could be as long as it's already has already been, and even longer. We don't know. I just know this, that I'm going to keep till he comes. Amen. I just know I'm going to keep going forward. I'm going to keep swinging a sword until he takes me home. And I don't want a shortcut. I want to finish my mission. Amen. So we find then that it actually goes on to describe, amazingly, in the Septuagint, we find from 1 Samuel 9:9, the Hebrew equivalent means the seeing one or the seer. Good grief. Think about the magnitude of this word heed. And Paul, Jesus is literally saying to you, in this ministry of the Son of Man, you need to go according to the trend. Back in the, say, what, can you give me an example? Jesus is saying, yes, go back and look at the seers. Go back and look at the prophets. Yeah. Lord, are you kidding? I'm not a prophet. You want me to have that level? Don't worry. You've got the Holy Ghost. Amen. See, you've got the Holy Ghost. You've got a gene of God in you. You've got the gifts of the Spirit. You've got the fruits of the Spirit. You're coming back toward the Garden of Eden. Don't worry. Just do this. Make sure you have fellowship with the mystery so you can take heed and have the eyesight of a seer. Say, oh, I'm so afraid. Don't be afraid. This thing isn't about fear. I'm not here today for you to take all your kids home and lock them in a closet and put chains on them and say, I'm never letting you back out in the world again. All you need to do is have the vision of a seer. Have that kind of relationship with God. The devil won't get within a mile of your children. You can't raise kids in a bubble. You'll do more harm doing it that way. But have the eyesight of a seer, so that you can guide them and so that they can see your track record and thus have confidence in you. See? That's why he says in Revelation 3:18, I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire. You know, when an enemy wants to slip something past you, now this is just we just speak about warfare. There's a lot of warfare going on in the world right now. There, since the first woe began, the world has never been without war all over the place. And we find that when the enemy wants to slip something past you or take you by surprise, what he's got to do is he's got to create a distraction. Amen. See? And so he catch your attention away. And I mean, that's a street fighting tactic. Distract the guy and then pop him. Amen? Because you definitely want to strike first. Amen. I didn't get too many amens out of that. Amen. I'm talking about the devil. What did y'all, y'all thought I was, no, I'm talking about the devil. You're going to want to strike first. Listen, that's the way Israel does. Did you know that you mass your troops on Israel's border, you know what they'll do? They'll attack you. They don't wait to be attacked. Not anymore. That day is done. You don't threaten Israel and not get struck. See? And that should be your way as a family of God. Fathers, mothers, teenagers. As soon as you see the enemy come in, make a strike. At least get his attention and let him know you're awake. Hey, I just want you to understand, oh boy, I see what you're doing. That ain't going to work in my home. That ain't going to work. You're not coming in here with that kind of nonsense. You see him try to pop up, move into a church. Oh, no, you don't. We see your tactics. We got a warning from a prophet you'd try to do that. Oh, we're going to join in prayer, and we're going to make your life so miserable that you'll either, Brother Branham said, you'll either repent and become one of us, or you'll go out from us. Hallelujah. I'm here to tell you there's liberty and there's power in the family of God. So heed then, the word heed then is an ability to see the real threat apart from the distraction. This is why Revelation 3 would say, I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich in white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. You know, you can't, as Brother Branham would use in his illustration, people trying to make themselves good enough. And Brother Branham would say, you know, without a new birth, without the real baptism of the Holy Ghost, you know, self-improvement is fine. Living a Christian lifestyle, whether you're born again or not, is a good thing. I mean, you'll be healthier, keep more of your money, probably live longer. You'll be more well thought of in the community. And I'm not even saying God won't take note of a life. Paul talked to those Jews who were so uppity with their way of thinking, and Paul said, good grief, said, wouldn't the heathen, that if he keeps the law without your law, becomes a law to himself? And wouldn't God accept him? You think God's a respecter of persons? You have the law and you think that just because you have that, you've got some advantage? You don't have any advantage. So that's the mercy of God making a way for the heathens who never, Brother Brown talked about when Jesus was there, not even 1% of Israel. I mean, what about the islands and the heathens and the nations that were just totally heathen? Children born in heathenism and died in heathenism. You see? And so God had to have a way because his throne is established in mercy. See? You don't ever want to think of God, that Catholic view of God loves me and God hates me, but Jesus loves me. That's what Brother Branham was tormented with as a child. See? Don't ever make God a sadistic person. Don't ever do that. Don't ever imagine him that way. He in fact, is he's so pure that he can even get angry and sin not. Amen. And he cautions you to do the same thing. Now, you don't quite possess that, so you got to let him do it through you. Yeah, right. That really takes fellowship with the Holy Spirit. He can actually take revenge, tells you not to do it, but he does it. Is he hypocritical? No, it's just he knows who really deserves it. And he also knows each individual person. He knows each individual heart. He considers the heart. See, even when we, and I'm going to get ahead of myself, I'm not careful, but we talk about blaspheming the Holy Ghost. Yeah, you can absolutely blaspheme the Holy Ghost, but make sure you understand the main way that happens, because you don't ever want to have it to where you're saying, you know, you've got God, you know, sitting over in a corner pouting because you disbelieved his word and he's going to burn you in the lake of fire. God's not moody like that. He's not vindictive like that. That's a perverted vengeance. That's perverted judgment. Does he have wrath? He absolutely does. But he's not unjust in his wrath. See? So I have more to say, more on that to come. I'm determined not to get into that, but it's so fresh in my heart. I can feel myself being pulled that way. But Brother Branham would say, you know, without the real new birth of the Spirit of God, then you're just a blackbird trying to stick peacock feathers. Yeah. I've never heard anyone use that analogy except William Branham. In all the readings I've read all my entire life, never heard that analogy. Brother Branham says, you're just trying to take peacock feathers and stick them in your tail to make everybody think that you're a peacock when you're really just a blackbird, see? But I mean, if you really were a peacock, then why do you only wear those feathers on Sundays and Wednesdays? Why don't you wear them at school? I'm not going to go to school wearing them. Are you kidding me? I'll get laughed at. Why don't you wear them on the job? Oh, it'll give me a disadvantage. Listen, friends, stop chasing peacock feathers. They'll just fall out anyway. You're going to have to get new ones every week. They don't last. Amen? You want to be born again, and you want to grow, not just peacock feathers, eagle feathers. Hallelujah. See? See, so we're not just trying to merely stick peacock feathers in our tail and imagine that somehow that's going to meet the challenges of this hour. It will not. The day is too evil. See? Satan has far too much influence in the world. The word of God must be a living word because the word of God is a weapon of war. Amen. Brother Brown talks about that, how that each messenger in the ages said a seal was partially opened and a mystery dropped down and a messenger caught it, one of those stars, seven stars in his right hand, a messenger caught it and ran with it, and his message was a trumpet. Because you have a trumpet to the Jews, but you have a gospel trumpet. Amen. You understand? Don't confuse the two. And so he would go forth with a gospel trumpet. That's why John says, I heard behind me a voice as the sound of a trumpet. And turning to see, I saw this. And so we find then that he says it gathers a bride. And then the messenger dies. The God takes his church home. Under the first resurrection, they denominate the system and they reject the word, and God drops a temporary judgment. Amen. Amen. And then moves on to the next age. And then another, and at the certain time, another age and a half, by two, maybe sometimes three ages, then he partially opens another seal. And another messenger grabs that and takes off running with it. It blows a trumpet. It gathers a people. Then there's a rejection. He pulls his family out, drops a temporary plague, and moves on. See? So we find then that the word is a weapon of war. So that's why we read a voice like a trumpet. Now, interestingly, trumpets are used in worship. there's the whole balance between, you know, worshiping under the Spirit. You say, well, how do I differentiate worship under the Spirit of God versus worship of God, but that's not done in the Spirit of God? That's a good question, and there's a good answer. That the worshipers that Jesus is looking for will worship in spirit and truth. Amen. See? So it's not worship for the sake of worship. It's a worship of a God who has become so real that the real you down underneath all that flesh can't help but lift up those hands, can't help but lift up that voice, can't help but have feelings of love and admiration for this God. It's not just fuzzy feelings. It's not just filial love. It's not just pep rally. It's not just excitement. It's not just running and jumping and hollering and let's get the music louder and faster and louder and faster till somebody starts shouting. I've been in some services like that, and it was wonderful when it was real, and it was disgraceful when it wasn't. And I'm for all versions of real. Come on, I need a bigger amen than that. I'm for all versions of real. Hallelujah. When it's based on, we know what we're shouting about. We've had an experience in the Holy Ghost, and God is coming down with his word, and there's an appreciation in our hearts, and we say, give me some more, give me some more. I tell you, it becomes a glory train. And we love that, desire that, crave that, wish that for every single service. But now let's look at it a minute. Trumpets represent the gospel. Trumpets are also used in worship. But when we look at a trumpet representing the gospel, we see that it's a trumpet of the living word. Because what that simply means is that it's a revelation. It's a voice. John said, I turn to see the voice. Amen. See? It commanded my attention. It sounded like a trumpet. I turned to see the source of this voice that was speaking to me. So it's the voice of a person. So the word then is a weapon of war that comes against the powers of darkness. And I want to say this, that this weapon of this kind of a trumpet, amen, supersedes a physical trumpet blowing in a worship service. Or any instrument blowing in a worship service. Any instrument in a worship service, this is far more superior. In fact, is the whole design of the worship service prior is to prepare your hearts and minds to receive this. You understand? So then the lesser then becomes of more importance by the greater that it leads you to. You follow that. So it supersedes a physical trumpet. This is where Pentecost missed it. Now, I'm not talking about the original Pentecost. I'm talking about the remnants of the Azusa Revival. The remnants of the Azusa Revival decided to just chase after all of that emotionalism. And they didn't even need the word anymore, which frankly they had rejected it anyway. And they were unaware and unwilling to admit that the Spirit of God, there was Ichabod over the door, the Spirit of God had long departed. You say, aren't some of those real tears that they're crying, and aren't those people very sincere? They sure are, and they sure are crying real tears. And you realize that the rain does fall on the just and the unjust. But is it tears leading to euphoria? Or let me say, is it tears as a result of real euphoria? Or is it tears leading to repentance and a changed life by accepting the word? And what we see in the charismatic movement of today is we see just that. We see a lot of emotion. We see a lot of music. We see singing and playing. That it blows you away. Sometimes even as a believer, sometimes you can be listening to some of those charismatic services and, oh my goodness, the singing and the people leaping and jumping, and you feel like leaping and jumping yourself. But there's a vast difference in you because by and large, when they jump and they hit the ground, they walk sideways. When you jump and hit the ground, you walk straight. Because why? You've had an experience with the mystery. And so we want all of that, but I want to have an experience with the mystery. It's got to be in spirit and in truth. See? It's wonderful. So it supersedes the physical trumpet, is the gospel trumpet. It supersedes a trumpet blowing in a worship service. So it is more the word ministered and believed in the heart of the believer. I'm here to tell you, that's what puts the enemy under your feet. It will not do you much good to have a spirit-filled man singing to you today as you had, talking about your feet. And we all want to put Satan under our feet. But I'm here to tell you that unless there's a belief in your heart of the word coming forward, that's what puts Satan under your feet. And then you've got something to sing about. Then you've got something for rejoicing and fiery revival. And even I'll even take some wildfire as long as it's believing every word of God. And allowing the word to have sway in its life. It's shocking that there should be so much confusion over that. That you have people that seemingly want to just go dry word and no emotion and no worship and no nothing. And then you have people who just want to go all of that and no word. And it's just all, you know, I don't want to keep using the word Pentecost. Here's what it is. Pentecostalism. It's not the Pentecost of this Bible. Because the Pentecost of this Bible was written as a book of Acts because people acted. Because they acted like Christ. Not because they worshiped and sang, but because it made a living difference in them. See? And so, why is it so hard to have a balance? Because the enemy goes about. The enemy doesn't want you balanced. The enemy wants you over here with a dead letter, or he either wants you over here with a big bunch of nonsense and no walk in your life and no power of God to overcome. But I'm here to tell you good news. You can have both. You don't have to choose. You can have both. Glory to God. Worship and music, there's healing in that. You know, there's healing in worship. There's healing in music. Music and worship, especially if the lyrics say, you know, I was loving that song Sister M sung a couple of times ago because she was literally singing the Bible, literally singing the verses. I just can't get away from that song. I'm going to preach a whole sermon on Sister Emily. Oh, my, just blowed me up. I can't listen to it without weeping every time, but I'm here to tell you something, friends. We got something real. You know, it doesn't have to be put on. It doesn't have to be show. It's not about that. That God can move in your life and make a real son and daughter of God out of you, who can give you the real fire-breathing experience of the Holy Ghost, change your old nature, make you a brand new creation in God, heal your body, deliver you from demon power. God can move. God still moves. Hallelujah. He moves physically for you, spiritually, emotionally, financially. What do you think the new birth is? It's divine healing in the soul. The word of God is health to all your flesh, mind, body, soul. There's healing in worship. There's deliverance in the preaching of the gospel. There's deliverance with worship. There's power. I want to say that again. There's healing in the hearing of the word. There's healing in worship. There's deliverance in the receiving of the word. There's deliverance in worship. So why would you choose one or the other when you can have both? God is in his word. Say, God is in his word. But God inhabits the praises of his people. And more importantly, perhaps its most important role, as we said, is to prepare the hearts to receive the word. You know, because you're going to want to have faith in the word. So So Holy Ghost worship prepares you to receive the promise, because that's what your faith, the worship is going to prepare you to receive the promise. And if you receive the promise, you get the benefit. See? So this is why Brother Branham would point to Israel going to battle with singing at the lead. That's in the scripture. Literally, the army of Israel in the Old Testament marched off to war, and it wasn't their recon troops at the head of the army. It was singers. Musicians. We're going to go fight a nation. Who's going to be the tip of the spear? Our singers? No, I mean, who's going to battle? Our musicians? No, I mean, who's going to face the enemy? Uh-huh. First? Oh, yeah. Because that's going to give us courage. See? Say, that's a crazy way to fight. Well, not as long as we've got a God saying that if you keep my statutes and walk in my ways, you'll go to war and won't lose a man. You'll never be. You'll be undefeatable in battle, and all your people will be bulletproof. Hallelujah, friends. See, understand, the world might not understand it, but to the family of God, it makes perfect sense that we go to war with worship. And I'm not just talking about somebody up here merely on a guitar, or merely on a set of drums, or merely on a piano, or merely playing a trumpet. I'm talking about that your life has the music of the Holy Spirit. Your life has the presence of the living God. That's what Satan is afraid of. See? So, the army marched off to war, led by singers and musicians, and why wouldn't they? When they're told by God that they would be undefeatable, and that in any battle they wouldn't suffer a single casualty. Worship and singing. Listen now, I'm going to turn a corner. You ready? Hanging on? You buckled in? Still got me? Worship thus. Worship and singing is an evidence of warfare.
Amen.
It's an evidence of warfare. Sometimes when I look out and I sadly see people, you know, that they sit under very well-led worship, very much Holy Ghost worship, and they just have no worship within them at all. You know, it indicates to me you're more on the sideline. You're certainly not at war. You're certainly not at war. You're here to be at war. We didn't get put here to go to Disney World. I've been there. Go again tomorrow. Take my grandkids. But that's not why I'm here. I'm here to fight. I'm here to be a warrior. I'm here to be a soldier. I'm not here to lay in a field hospital. I know sometimes we have to retreat from the front lines and go lay in a field hospital. I know we can get wounded and injured and hurt and sick and wearied. Oh my, I love that. Who was singing that song, our brother Aaron, this morning? Oh, weariness is going to be over, friends. We're headed for a time where we won't be weary anymore. But until then, my heart will go on singing. Until then, with joy, I'll carry on. Hallelujah. I'm not here to sit on the sideline or lay in a field hospital or get sent home from the front. I'm here to fight. I want to be like Uriah in the Bible. I can't take my ease when my brothers and sisters are in war. When there's no worship in your life, there's no war in your life. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Oh my, you're not really fighting against evil, not at any serious level. Say, Brother Jason, you're hurting my feelings. I'm not trying to do that. It should be a spiritual barometer to you of your spiritual condition.
Yes. Amen.
That's why we're preaching, to help you to get it, to help you to go, like Brother Eugene says, have an aha moment. Wow. I don't have any worship in my life. Not really. I love the Lord. I believe Him. I even come to church. I clap my hands. Goodness, what do you want from me? I'm not talking about you running up and down the aisles. I'm talking about what happens when you leave this building. I'm talking about in this building and out of this building. Why does there have to be an either or? You should bring the Holy Ghost to the service. Hallelujah. There should be praise in here because praise drove here. There should be freedom and liberty coming here because freedom and liberty got in its car and drove here today. And when we come in, we're here to receive more grace and more liberty and more instruction, reproof, correction, whatever we need. But whatever it is, I'll lift up my hands and say, praise God, praise God. Pour it on, Lord. Give me more of what you need to give me. Hallelujah. Trumpets give battle direction. Friends, listen. No wonder some genuine believers are aimless in their life. I mean, I would love to do nothing but preach this to you and work you all up into a lather of praise, and we'd pour out in the street drunk on the Holy Ghost. Have to explain it to the authorities. Good luck with that. I'm sorry to have to keep thinking we're going to get a runaway, and then I have to stop and pull you back again and go, listen. Sometimes believers, real believers, for real believers now. Now, I'm not talking about people who just had living at a, you know, never really been born again. I'm talking about people who are born again, who really love God. They really do for real. They really do believe the word. They really do. They want victory in their lives, but their lives are just aimless. Do you understand that trumpets give battle direction? The gospel, I'm not talking about now the one we blow in a worship service. I'm talking about the one John turned to see. You need to turn and see the voice that speaks to you today. You need to realize it's one like unto the Son of Man. Hallelujah, friends. Can you accept that today? I know I'm just a human. I know I'm flesh and blood. I know I got my ups and downs. The whole thing that's foolishness to me is God's going to use imperfect men to perfect imperfect men. Go figure. But here it is, and here it's for you if you want it. And I'm here to tell you, God will put direction in your life. You don't have to be aimless and purposeless. You don't have to be depressed and wonder what's life really about. This can give you purpose. It can make your life a living example, a living worship that when people get around you, they want to worship. See? Sometimes believers can't even figure out their life, even in general life. No spiritual direction at all, see? And I'm just not sure your spiritual heart has very much worship going on. Amen. When it's like that. Trumpets declare victory. Hallelujah. I got 5 minutes. Amen. Amen. Trumpets not only give direction, they declare victory. Trumpets announce the presence of the king. When he comes into the camp, it's a time of rejoicing. It's a time, why? And it's not just, listen, it's not just pomp and circumstance. The king is in the camp. We're at church today. Oh, we got our favorite singers singing specials. We got our favorite song leader. We got our favorite musicians. All today is going to be terrible. We don't have brother so-and-so, sister so-and-so. When the king come into the camp, it wasn't just pomp and circumstance. What caused the people to rejoice was the confidence it brought. What joy, the joy that it brought to their lives and brought, that's why it's called the shout of the king is in the camp. That's what happened when Balaam, in the days of Balaam, Balaam tried to tell Balak, said, I've told you to curse him. He said, I can't. Said, well, why not? Because the shout of the king is in their camp. Well, what's that supposed to mean? It means they got too much faith. My curse wouldn't do any good. They just throw it off because they got faith in Jehovah. Why do they have such faith? Because they're in fellowship with the mystery. Hallelujah, they're rejoicing because confidence. Say, what brought confidence? Because when the king is in the camp, you don't worry about the enemy. When the king is in the camp, you don't worry about trials. When the king is in the camp, you don't worry about circumstances. You just say, the king is here, everything's gonna be okay. And And that's what we want in our services. That's what we want in our lives, to say, the King is here. I know the devil's busy, but the King is here. I got this problem in my body, but the King is here. Hallelujah. I got this situation. I got that situation. We got this in the church. We got this in the family. We got this in a marriage. But the King is here. Let the people rejoice. Because now the enemy is as good as beaten. Hallelujah. You believe it today, friends. The presence of the King. Oh, the enemy, he might be marshaling on your border. But when the King arrives, there's rejoicing in the camp. Things can look scary. Things can look scary. But when the King arrives, everything's going to be fine. Oh, we're saved, friends. We're saved, Bethel Tabernacle. Just in the nick of time, the King is here. I know the world is evil. I know it's being destroyed. I know it's burning down around us. But the King, we have the presence of the King. Oh, my. My, my, my. That should be your message to the enemy. You better run for the hills, Satan. The King is here. Amen. You better run, old boy. He better run. He better quit trying to afflict our bodies. He better get out of our homes. He better get out of our marriages. He better stop trying to steal our children. The King is here. Hallelujah. We're here to face the enemy with a challenge of the Holy Ghost because we have believed the report. We turn to see the voice that spoke. And I say it's the Messiah. I say it's Christ in my life. And there's authority now in the bride of Jesus Christ. So we say, get out of our homes. Get out of our marriages. How many will say it today? Get out of my children. Get out of my marriage. Get out of my home. Get out of this church. Get out of my business. Get out of my mind. I have the King. So what does true worship in spirit, what does that do? It gathers people for more word to come forward. So you realize then that worship then is a connection force. True worship connects you. It's never a performance. It's not about that. It's never a performance. It's a tool to lift the human spirit into the heavenly realm. It connects the temporal to the eternal. Do you believe that? It joins the mortal to the immortal. How many want that? So I'm just a mortal man. I'm so weak, but I have an opportunity to be connected to the immortal realms. I have an ability to walk in heavenly places in Christ Jesus with all authority. Oh, my friends, it's as I said to you, it amazes me, you know, that there's some kind of there's some kind of debate over this. And like as if there's two sides. And there's not. Amen. There's not two sides in the truth. There's only one truth. I'm here to tell you there's not this side or that side. I'm not here to correct one side or the other. Because worship, when you have a word emphasis, they both involve actions of the Holy Ghost. Yeah. Both of them do. The preaching of the gospel, the singing of specials, the playing of music, the leading of worship. It all involves the Holy Spirit. It's not you, it's Him. You're not the worthy one. He's the worthy one. Oh, we have no pride. I appreciate Brother JD's sermon today. That's the way we get the Spirit of God here, is throw down our pride, friends. I'm not here. I have nothing to correct. I'm not coming to correct. I'm coming to declare the King is among us today. Hallelujah. Do you believe that, friends? Stand up, King's children. Stand up, King's family. The King is in our midst today. Hallelujah. I believe that with all of my heart, all my mind, all of my soul. I believe that we have the presence of the King. It's too, you say, well, you know, there's this camp, there's that camp. Well, that's just the devil's doing. There's no division in God's word. There's no division in God's family. The Holy Ghost isn't double-minded. Thank God for that. He's not double-minded. Sometimes we tend to be, but he's not double-minded. He's very sure of himself. His presence is real. Amen. As they play something for me softly, Sister Deb, Brother Tony, whatever is your choice, bow your heads with me. with your heads bowed and your hearts bowed and your eyes closed. The life in the Word. This was what I was ministering to you the last two Sundays. The life in the Word. Be happy, friends. Be thankful. Let the kingdom of God rejoice, because the bride hath indeed made herself ready. God has done a great thing in our day, and God is doing something even greater now, because it's going forward. And with every new 24-hour day, I know, listen, friends, with your heads bowed, I know with every day the world gets more evil. But I'm here to tell you, with God and His bride, every day gets brighter and brighter. There's more control of the Holy Spirit to be had, and I want to have as much as I can get and then some. How many want to raise up a hand to say, Lord, take control of my life? With my head bowed and your heads bowed, just raise up those hands to God, those eagle wings, and say, Lord, take control of my life. I'm unable to navigate it. I make a mess of things, but take control. Bring worship into my life. Lord, set me on the front lines of warfare. Let me have fellowship with the mystery. Grant it to us, Lord. We love you today. We thank you for this assemblage of people. Thank you, Lord, for those who are listening today. I know the Word has had as much effect on them as it had on me. As I studied it and ministered it, Lord, I can see its effect on them. Lord, the enemy isn't going to like this. He's going to already trying to plot a solution to just remind people, as soon as they get out of this anointing, going to try to remind them, hey, I'm still here. Well, he's still nobody too. Lord, when he announces his presence, I just say, hey, Mr. Nobody, you better run for the hills, because the king is in my camp now. How do I get the king in my camp? Worship him, adore him, love him, keep his promises, keep his word. Let it be a lamp to your feet. Let it be a light in your eye. Let it be something that leads you on the paths of righteousness. I promise you, this king is undefeated in battle. Never lost, never can lose, never will, never can. He's faithful. He's loyal. He'll be the most loyal companion, friend you'll ever have or ever could have. Oh, just draw him closer to your heart today, friends. This is on you. Let the mind which was in Christ be in you. Let the word dwell in you richly. You got to let these things happen. You got to allow it. Make room for Christ in your heart. Say, Lord, begin a song in my soul. Begin a worship in my soul. Begin a fellowship in my soul, a fellowship with a mystery. Let me be like John. Today I came, I heard a voice like a trumpet, and I turned to see the voice that spake to me, and it was Christ. It wasn't just a preacher in the pulpit. It wasn't Brother Jason. That's not the one I turned to see. I turned and I saw one like the Son of Man. One like the Son of God. It was the Son of God. Hallelujah. Lord, may it be real in our lives today. We love you. We thank you. Thank you for bringing this to us, Lord. As I've studied it and looked at it so closely, kept myself very near your presence and kept my material very close to the vest, Lord, saying very little even to my ministry team, knowing that I wanted to come and bring balance on this issue that's so easy to understand. It's not complicated. They that worship me must worship in spirit and truth. What's complicated about that? Help us, Master. I thank you for the freedom of worship in Bethel Tabernacle. I thank you for the liberty that people feel to lift their voices and clap their hands and stand to their feet. And Lord, I thank you for the liberty that we see in our worship service. But Lord, even more than that, I thank you for the liberty I have to preach the gospel. I thank you for the reception in this audience. Lord, with hands that move above their head and defy gravity when the word comes forth, and with their actions, they're saying amen to every word. And not only their hands, but their voices declare, amen, amen. Glory to God. Praise God. It echoes across this building. I'm grateful for that, Lord. May it ever be that way. May we never find ourselves left of center out in a field somewhere. Lord, somehow, Lord, some people get so far away, they're not even in the field at all. They're out somewhere gone. Oh, God, preserve the spirit of worship in this church. Preserve the love for your word in this church. Bring more humility to us, Lord. As we were hearing in our Sunday school lesson today, make us humble. Let us stomp down pride under our feet. Let us put the devil under our feet. March forward in victory. See the Holy Spirit in our young people. See it in our older people. See it in our marriage couples. See it in our singles. See it in boys. See it in girls. See it in men. See it in women. See it in the ministry. See it in the officers. See it everywhere, Lord. That when people see us, they'll see you. Grant it, Father. Grant it, I pray. We love you for it. In Jesus' name. Let's sing, Brother Anthony.
Peace of God, cover me.
Oh, sing that now.
Cover me. Cover me. Peace of God, cover me.
Grant it, Lord. Hallelujah.
Through the storm,
cover me, Lord.
Cover me. Peace of God, cover me.
Oh, let's just worship Him now, friends. Raise up those hands. This is a prayer song.
Cover me.
This is a prayer song. This is something you're praying.
Cover me.
Oh, sing it to the Lord tenderly. Peace of God.
Peace of God.
Cover me, Lord.
Cover me.
Cover our minds and our homes.
Through the storm, cover me.
Sing this truth
now. Sing, only in you I am saved.
Only in you.
Only.
Only in you
I'm secure.
Cover me.
So cover me. Cover me. Cover me when I am hurting.
Yes, Lord.
Cover me when I'm not strong.
Hallelujah.
Cover me when I am going through the storm.
Give Him some worship. Give Him some praise. He'll meet your need.
Cover
whatever it is today, the King's in the camp. He's here.
Peace of God, cover me.
Hallelujah.
Through the storm.
Oh, we worship you in spirit and truth. We worship you in freedom today, Lord.
Only in say,
hallelujah.
Sing, only in you I'm secure. me. He's a God, cover me through the storm. Cover me, peace of God. Peace of God, cover me. Cover me. Cover me. Peace of God, cover me through the storm. Cover.
Hallelujah!
Cover me when I'm not strong.
Lord, we thank you today. Thank you for your presence in our midst, Lord. We thank you for your word. Thank you for your faithfulness, your righteousness, your cleanness. We love your cleanness. We love your holiness. We crave it. We desire it. We desire it, Lord, your righteousness above my daily bread. I know it doesn't always look that way, Lord, in my life. I'm sorry for that. We're all sorry for that, Lord. But right here, while the spirit of honesty is among us, while the spirit of truth is here, we just raise up our hands and say, help us, Lord. We believe, help our unbelief, oh God. Help us to believe every word of God and let it be made material in our lives. You know that's the greatest desire of our heart. To be servants of God. Go with us now today to our homes, to our fellowship, to our meals. May we accomplish all the purposes, Lord, that you have set for us and made today. We come a little closer to the image you saw of us before the foundation of the world. May I capture that today. Now, I'll ask you for a fresh dose of it tomorrow for sure, but I want to make sure I catch it today. May you grant it. We commit these people into your hands. In Jesus' name. God bless you, friends. You can be dismissed in Jesus' name. At your leisure, go in the love of God. God bless you. Don't forget Brother Kenny's announcement.
I'm a pilgrim and a stranger, wandering through this world of sin, on my way to that fair city. When the saints go marching in, oh, when the saints go marching in, oh, when the saints go marching in, oh, Lord, I want to be in that number. When the saints go marching in, oh, when the saints go marching in, oh, when the saints go marching in, oh, Lord, I want to be in.